Dr. Mollie Marti, welcome to Resiliency Matters. This is where we take the big resiliency research and break it down into small, bite-sized pieces that you can use immediately. We promise that you will leave the show with three takeaways that you can start using in your life. So, what if you could learn the biggest mistakes that coaches make and how to avoid them so that you can better coach as a parent, a teacher, a youth builder? Would you hang out with us for 28 minutes? What if in the next 10 minutes you could learn how to work with the natural defenses that youth put up so that you can move around them and have greater influence? Would you hang out with us? Who is us? Welcome to the other half of us today, my friend Mitch Matthews. Mitch is an business coach. He has his own coaching certification program. He's the author of Ignite, and he's known as the Big Dream Guy. He's earned this reputation for two reasons. One is that he is co-founder of the Big Dream Gathering, which we are going to talk about today. And the other is that he is on a personal mission to unleash 1 million big dreams in his lifetime. Welcome, Mitch Matthews.
Thanks so much, Mollie. It's an honor to get to be here. I love it.
Thank you for coming all the way up from West Des Moines to
Absolutely.
Be with us today.
Absolutely.
And I can't help but think back to how we first met. And
yeah.
A member of my team called me and said, Mollie, I met this guy. Number one, his energy is through the roof.
Dangerous levels, right?
Yeah. And number two, your work has such a congruency that you need to bring him in.
Mm.
And so sight unseen, I brought you
yeah.
to my Make an Impact Live event in Chicago, where you held a big dream gathering.
Yeah.
And then my recollection is I begged you to come back the second year
you
to do
I was happy to do it. Absolutely.
So there's a testament to your work. But let's bring our audience up to speed here. What
sure.
is the Big Dream Gathering?
Well, the Big Dream Gathering kind of is it's something that started as a happy accident when my wife and I were working on one of our own big dreams. But basically what the event is it's something where people can come and kind of give themselves permission to think about some of their big dreams, write them down, and then anonymously post them on the walls. And then we encourage everybody to go around and see if they could help each other with those big dreams. And we've had all sorts of crazy stories come from it. Businesses being launched, vacations being taken, all sorts of different things that have been really amazing to see.
And you tell so many great stories
yeah.
when I attend your big dream gatherings. And you probably know what one I'm going to ask you to share. I think I have a favorite. And that's about when you knew you needed a new category of
sure.
dreams. What's that story?
Absolutely. Well, we have categories so people can kind of organize the dreams. The business category, the health and fitness, relationships. But I think the one you're talking about, we needed to add a category of dreams that defy categorization. Because we were doing a big dream gathering in North Carolina. And a man came up to me with his dream sheet to say, hey, which category do you think it should go in? And the person, he was a middle-aged man, really, a blue button-down collar shirt and khaki pants and penny loafers with shiny pennies in them. And so I expected on his dream sheet maybe to say, go after my MBA, start business school, maybe start my own accounting practice. It simply said, I want to learn how to drive monster trucks. Awesome. So we needed a new category of dreams that defy categorization.
That is yeah. so. Still makes me laugh.
I love
so
it.
I can't imagine all the stories you have. Can you share another story, one of maybe your favorites, but especially how it relates to youth builders?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, there are so many great stories of people kind of getting clear on some of their dreams, writing them down, and then getting help or giving help. I mean, it's an amazing process to watch out. But one of my favorite dream or stories from the Big Dream Gathering is especially into what we're talking about today, happened in Topeka, Kansas. We did a big dream gathering there, and one of the people that showed up was a family. It was a group, and the dad and the son came up to me. And the dad was kind of a strong businessman from the community, kind of almost stoic. And then his son was with him. And I said, I looked at both of them, I talked with both of them, but I looked specifically at the son and I said, what's one of your big dreams? What are you shooting for? What are some of the things you're gonna write down? And he said, I don't know. I'm not sure if I have any dreams. And I could see the father kind of maybe bristle a little bit. I think he had some opinions about maybe what some of his son's dreams should be. But it was great because he kind of held himself and he was like, he just kind of gave his son permission to dream and explore. And so he went around and looked at some of the dreams and those types of things. And throughout the night, I kind of checked in with him just to see how things were going. But about 15 minutes before it was done, they both came up to me. And the son came up and he was just beaming at this point. I said, did you get some dreams? And he said, yeah, I wrote four down. I said, what's one of your favorites? And he said, well, one of my favorites is I think I know what I want to be when I grow up. And I said, oh, what's that? And he said, well, I think I want to be an inventor. was like, oh, that's great. And he took off to write more dreams down and look at other dreams. And the dad stepped up. And, you know, again, this was kind of a hard, successful businessman. But I noticed he was misting up and had a tear coming down. I was like, what's going on? Are you okay? And he said, I realized, you know, I always wanted to be an inventor when I was his age, but nobody ever asked me. And I love that about the Big Dream Gathering, where people kind of give themselves that permission to dream. But I love that story in particular, because I know that dad probably had dreams for his kid, mm-hmm. and maybe even had opinions about what his son's dreams should be, but he let his son explore that. He supported him, he let him explore it, but really let his son own that. And I think that made it even a more powerful experience for the son.
Is great, and there's certainly a takeaway within that.
Absolutely.
Let's get more. You know, I'm specific.
All about
driven,
the tools,
all
right?
Yeah, all about the tools.
Absolutely.
So we have just some passionate, caring youth builders. I know who's on the other side here, and
absolutely.
I want to help them. So their house might look like mine, where I have some big dreamers, and we're talking about those dreams, and I have some that are a little more quiet and not, you know, willing to share. So what can you say to our youth builders on how do you begin this conversation with your kids?
Absolutely. Well, I think it's a great question. And again, anybody that's pouring into kids, I commend, because that's a big deal and that's so important. But when the subject of dreaming big and what are some of your big dreams comes up, like you said, some kids are all about it and other kids are like, I have no idea. Mm-hmm. So I even say, you know, one of your initial questions, how you word it and how you approach it makes all the difference. So some people will come up say, well, what's your big dream? And a lot of times kids will have no idea, or they'll all of a sudden start processing, well, what's my one big dream or what's my biggest dream? And all of a sudden, instead of kind of exploring and expanding their thought, they're shutting down and kind of weighing out, what should they say? Mm-hmm. So in some ways, start with a more broad-based question to be able to say, what are some of your dreams? What are some of the things you'd love to do or experience or see, as opposed to what's that one big dream? So you kind of allow a more broad question, and kind of like that dad at that big dream gathering, give them the chance to explore some options and opportunities, as opposed to trying to narrow it down to just one.
That's such great information.
Yeah.
And real quick, how do you connect coaching and parenting? Because I want to make sure that everyone comes back and follows on this conversation. What's the connection between coaching and parenting?
Well, I think there's so many parallels between the two roles. And we'll talk more about specific strategies that I even as a parent and a coach, I see those parallels and we can pull them through. But so much of parenting, I think, is helping your kids to grow and expand and learn from as they walk out their life, their journey. And so much of that can be as we kind of allow ourselves that chance to put on our coach's hat and help them explore those things. It can make all the difference in the world.
So that's our first takeaway. Lower defenses by asking questions instead of giving answers. The biggest mistakes that shut down learning, we'll find out what they are and how you can avoid them with your children when we come back.
Hey, I'm Anderson Cooper. As a parent, you want to make sure that your child knows how to deal with bullying when they see it happening. And chances are they want to help, but they don't really know how. Well, teach them that the best thing to do is calmly walk away, find a teacher or other adult, and speak up. And do your part. Be that adult they can talk to and trust will listen. Join me to help stop bullying. Go to stopbullying.gov to find out more.
NFC, AFC, offensive linemen, defensive tackles, quarterbacks, and cornerbacks are all living united to ensure the academic success of millions of kids in our communities all the way to graduation day. But that won't happen without you. So take the pledge at unitedway.org. Make a difference in the life of a child. Suit up like your favorite NFL players and become a volunteer reader, tutor, or mentor with United Way.
You wouldn't walk through the halls of your school naked. Yet without thinking, many teens sext explicit photos of themselves to friends using cell phones, never thinking it'll go further. But once you hit send, you're exposed. You're out there in cyberspace for everyone to see. Sexting, it's dumb, it's dangerous, and it's against the law.
So this is my computer.
This is your computer. Let's go on the internet.
Let's go. Click it.
Yes.
Okay. eye cursor in between the R and the E.
If I say dot, I want you to just push the period.
She's gonna love me all over again now.
That's it. Jamaica, here you come.
Here we go.
Good job.
Thank you. Thank you. And I did it by myself. Feel smarter.
I'm Dr. Mollie Marti, and welcome back to Resiliency Matters. Today we are visiting with Mitch Matthews about coaching and parenting and what they have in common. And you have a really interesting concept about the hats that we wear.
Absolutely.
As a coach, as a mentor, as a parent, and how these different hats can get in the way of what we're really trying to achieve, and because they trigger habits.
Absolutely.
So talk us through that.
Well, yeah, you had mentioned we train people to be coaches, and one of the things that we do is we kind of remind people of our hats that we wear and some of the habits that are associated with that. So for example, you know, a lot of us wear a manager hat, you know, and we actually have people go, okay, what hats do I wear, right? And when you have your manager hat, there's probably elements of coaching that go into that where you're coaching your team to do well, those types of things. But there's habits that come or even biases that come when you have that manager hat on. You want your team to perform. You want your team to kind of stick to procedure or company policy, all those things. Mm-hmm. So you can coach, but sometimes those biases come with that manager hat or, you know, the parent hat, boy, you know, that so many of us wear and feel that, you know, a lot of times we want to coach our kids to do better. We want to stretch them and those types of things. But a lot of times the biases that come with that parent hat are around safety. We want to keep our kids safe, right? Mm-hmm. I want my kids to grow and stretch, but I also don't want to have them fall 20 feet out of a tree, right?
Right.
So it's one of those things when we put our coaching hat on, kind of one of the highest priorities or highest values that we can have when we coach someone is helping them to grow, not having all the answers, but instead asking them questions and helping them to grow. And sometimes that means allowing them to fail and learning from that as well. And so that's one of the things that we talk about when we're training coaches, but it's also something we talk about when we talk with parents about coaching, because there can be so much value in asking a question instead of always providing the answer. I mean, we tend to reject things that come from outside us, especially advice, even good advice. A lot of times we'll tend to shut that down. And I know kids do that, adults do that. But sometimes when you can ask a question and help someone discover the answer or own that answer, they have a lot more engagement. They feel a lot more connected to that. Give you an example of this. Our youngest son recently wanted to get into martial arts. And I thought, gosh, that's great. You know, now part of my parent hat wanted to kick in. I wanted to keep him safe. And I have some background in that. So I had some opinions. But I thought, you know what? This is a great kind of boundaried experience that I could coach him on. Instead of just kind of taking ownership and kind of driving it all on my side, I thought this is a great chance for me to just wear the coaching hat with my son. So I sat down with him and we looked at some of the martial arts schools in our area. And then we went to some of the martial arts schools, but I let him kind of pick. And then when we went, even though I had opinions on what the experience was like or what I thought maybe his experience would be like, or if I liked one more than the other, I asked questions instead of just giving him the answers and saying, well, what did you like? What didn't you like? What makes you think maybe this would be a good fit? Why might this not be a good fit? And he really got to own that process and that decision. And what was great about that was, although he made a slightly different decision than maybe I would have initially, he made a great decision. And it's really, really worked out. But more importantly, that process allowed him to make decisions and it allowed him to really own the process. So sometimes as parents, we want to give the answer in order to keep our kids safe or to speed up the process or whatever. But sometimes we need to, as parents, look for those boundaried opportunities to say, you know what? Instead, I'm going to wear the coaching hat here. And instead of having all the answers, I'm going to ask some questions and just kind of walk alongside them in this process to really allow them to own it and fully engage.
So a couple things you said that really stuck with me, and it's such a great story. But you're saying that we have these hats, we can be, and they trigger automatic processing.
Absolutely.
And I'm coming as a psychologist, right? So, but we there can be intentional choice, and we can take off the parent hat and put on the coach's hat.
Mm-hmm.
And it would help us perhaps if we draw boundaries. So let's start small. Let's say, okay, in this instance, I am going to not parent, but I'm going to coach. I'm going to support. I'm going to ask questions. I'm going to just see where my child takes this.
Absolutely.
And I think that's so helpful. And then another thing it triggered in me as a mother who just dropped her oldest child off to university. Is the issue of helicopter parenting, because you said that our main driver as a parent is to keep our children safe.
That's one of the biggest, absolutely.
And I think we have a lot of head nodding other end here with our viewers. And that's not a bad thing.
No.
We're charged with the safety of our kids. But there is a new and growing phenomena, and I work with a lot of athletic coaches and university professors, and one professor just shared an example that she had a parent who called her and was arguing about a test question on her daughter's exam.
Yeah.
And this is an adult.
Right.
Of an adult child.
Yep.
And so that helicopter parent, it comes from the idea that we have those lights on them, we're eyes hovering.
Yep.
So how would you say, if you have those tendencies, if you think that perhaps you are hovering too much, because that is an enemy of growing resiliency in our children.
Absolutely.
They need to stumble. They need to make their own mistakes. That's where they will learn.
Yeah.
Give us some more advice on how do I take off that parent hat and put on that coach's hat?
Well, you bring up a number of great points. One of the points, though, is looking for those boundary opportunities, because there are some times where we absolutely positively need to be the parent. Mm-hmm. We need to direct and put safe boundaries up. No texting while driving. No, you know, all those things, having specific rules. But to help avoid that helicopter parent experience, because what happens, and we do a lot of work with universities too, what winds up happening is those kids aren't able to make good decisions on their own. They're not able to filter through different options and actually make a call. A lot of times they have tough time engaging fully because someone's not guiding them throughout. So looking for those opportunities where maybe maybe a chance for your child to make a decision or to make some choices, instead of guiding them or telling them, instead choose to put that coaching hat on and say, you know, what might be a good thing to do here, or what might be a good option for you right now? Instead of just giving them the answer, ask another question and just help them to own that process.
And I think this